Balzer and Bray and Harper Audio present Strange Creatures by Phoebe North. Performed by Jesse Vilinsky, Shiromi Arserio, and Mark Sanderlin. I couldn't decide whose book this was. And then I realized I wrote it for the girl I never was, the boy I almost wasn't, and the person who survived them both. I dedicate this book to myself. Does that seem bold to you, vain? Do you wish I'd given it to you instead? Fine, here, take it. I wrote it for you too. To show you that if you live through this, then someday you can tell the story you'd hoped your whole life to find every time you turned a page. Bring it to me then, so I might tuck myself in with your book. Yours. My story's been told. I'm done with it. But the world can always use more books that are honest, strange, and true. I knew he was in danger because he was both the egg and the one who cracked it. Jessica Fisher. Epilogue. Every morning, Anit woke at dawn, while the two moons were still low against the horizon. Alone, she built her fire from the wood she'd gathered the evening before. Alone, she ate her meager breakfast, scraped her plates clean, dressed. There had been a time when she'd worn steel, a time when twin swords had dangled from her leather belt. If her men had doubted she had the strength to don her surcoat and arms, they never mentioned it. "Speak ill of the Imperata," they whispered to one another, "and she'll cut off your tongue." She had never cut off a man's tongue. That had been petty gossip. But she'd cut off other things. Now, no more armor. No more swords. The only weapon she carried was a small stone she'd found the evening before in the creek bed out back, tucked now into her pocket. The only armor she wore? An old tunic, secondhand and patched. A pair of men's trousers she'd found in someone's trash bin, and her old familiar dragon scale boots. They were her only finery, and they'd been a gift from her brother. A long, long time ago. She walked through the village, as she did every day. Today she was alone again, as usual. Until she wasn't. A small boy walked quietly beside her. The boy's hair was a disaster of black snarls. He kept his eyes down as he walked, although on occasion his gaze would dart up to ascertain that the old woman hadn't gone far. But in fact, the old woman kept pace with the child, matching stride to barefoot stride.
"I shouldn't take you past the village edge,"
the old woman said at last, as they neared the squalid row of mud and thatch houses at the end.
"Your mother wouldn't like it."
Anit had been here for 15 years at least. She knew every face, had lived here long enough to see some of the babies grow up to have babies of their own. She'd even made a friend or two, like Ija, the silversmith's only son, who occasionally traded her a spell for a cook pot or a spoon or some other useful trinket. But she didn't recognize the wide set of this boy's eyes or the growl that graced his lips when he replied, "You ain't taking me anywhere. I take myself." The corner of the old woman's mouth quirked upward in a smile.
"You do," she agreed. "Can't argue that."
And so, Anit began to climb a zigzag path up the side of the mountain. And as she went, she let the boy follow behind. Had she ever been so young, so determined? Must have been once. Her body bore the scars of it. But now she had only shadows of feelings, and none of them mattered. Now she lived a quiet life, a life without hurt or insult. There was no crying, but there was no hot passion either. And once, she had lived a life full of passions. Those vicious arguments with her brother, the spilled blood of a battle, and the celebration that came after. The music of a beautiful girl on a summer's day. The taste of wild mead on their lips as they joined their bodies together, their lives together, in the days before Anit had made an exile of herself. It had been inevitable. One cannot remove so many body parts without consequences. She knew that. And so she had accepted her fate willingly and without hesitation. And yet she found it pleasant now, after all these years, to have company. The boy's breath was a steady pulse, joining hers as the air grew thin and they drew close to the top of the mountain. It was on the far side that the old woman found it, her cairn swaying against the cliff's edge. The pile of stones was enormous, standing nearly twice her height, stacked narrowly at first and then growing wider, like an enormous egg. And like an egg, it had one smooth side. No instrument in this world could cut a rock or carve a piece of lime with such intention. Now Anit walked to the object's far edge, feeling over the cliff face for the hole she knew would be there. This close to the structure, she could hear a faint hum on the air, could taste the metallic twang of electricity. It was magic. Hers. But not only hers. Reaching out, she slipped the small stone into the gap. It fit as if it had been carved precisely for this purpose, though she knew it had been shaped by the river, by the water, by the inevitability of time. She stepped away, joining the boy on the path's edge, crouching low beside him in the grass there, looking at the cairn. Her head was cocked to one side as she considered. "No," she said softly. "It's still not right."
"What is it anyway?" he asked.
She laughed a little, a dry, rattly laugh, and shook her head.
"You might call it a beacon," she said.
She stood. She was looking at it from every angle now, her eyes tracing the smooth edges. There were no holes left in the cairn. Every stone had found its place.
"It calls out to other beacons across the world. There are two others. They're meant to work together. My first love built one on the shore of the Crystal Sea."
"And the third?"
asked the boy, wrinkling his nose. She turned to look at him, at the serious face beneath so much dirt.
"My brother," she said.
The two of them were quiet for a moment. Perhaps the boy was thinking about his own brother, if he had one, which he probably did. These village girls whelped children like they were puppies. But if that was the case, the boy said nothing about it. His face was merely a mud-stained, determined mask.
"Do theirs look the same as yours?" he asked.
Anit let out a scoff.
"No,"
she said, a little too sharply. She wasn't used to speaking to children. She wasn't used to talking to people, really, but especially children.
"Magic isn't like a knife or a spoon, where one design works best. Their beacons would be of their own making. I have no idea what theirs look like."
She fell silent, realizing, perhaps, that she'd been too harsh with him. When he answered, it was in a hard voice, too.
"And what do they do?"
he demanded, standing now as she had.
"These beacons."
He came closer to the cairn, closer to the cliff's edge. That wild hair had begun to stand on end in the presence of so much magic. He lifted a hand, almost but not quite, touching the beacon's smooth wall.
"Oh,"
Anit said, and she let out a sigh.
"It's supposed to crack open the eternal truth, and then rip a hole in the universe.
The boy turned, his hand still raised, and looked at her. Eyes like the dots on the bottom of a pair of wide, wild exclamation points.
Don't worry,
she said grimly. Now she reached out too, and put her hand against the cairn. She closed her eyes so she could better feel the hum of their music. Her own music, her lover's, her brother's. The three songs were almost, but not quite, a chorus. The notes were off-kilter, off-key, and worse, something was still hidden there. Some truth was still occluded. She said,
I built it wrong. It was meant to be magic, but there's no magic here.
That was a lie. There was magic everywhere, in every cell. In the stones, the cliff, the grass, the path. In this boy and his illiterate brain. In the girl who had taught her how to build beacons, stack stones, make art. So long ago that she'd been practically an illiterate child herself. In her brother, in some distant prison of his own making, a continent or two away from here. There was especially magic there. It had been there from the beginning, undeniable. It was still there, through the miles that stretched between them. The magic that bound them. The magic that had set them years and years ago out on this adventure. And yet it wasn't the magic she had wanted. She had wanted to capture something, to destroy something, to make something new. And she hadn't. Not yet. When she put her hand against the cairn, she felt how feeble it was. She could sense, though she could not see, small gaps between the stones. Imperfections. The truth was invisible to her. The door was closed. The door would never open unless she made a choice. She opened her eyes.
Tell me, child, what do you want with me? Some spell to bring your mother back from the dead?
Mother ain't dead either. Not yet, anyway.
He finally dropped his hand to his side. And then he looked back down at his bare toes, and how they wormed through the sun-warmed dirt.
I could teach you how to heal her,
the old woman said. The boy's eyes didn't brighten. And why should they? Who should blame him for not wanting to carry the burden of his mother's life, or death? But something still sparked inside that stormy gaze. Hunger.
Or I could show you something else.
What?
The boy demanded, looking up then, looking hard. He was so starved for it. She was too. Anit considered what it might cost. She would have to squander this meager, peaceful existence. Still, there had been time enough for peace already. Magic seared through her. And had from the very beginning, no matter how long she'd tried to deny it. She only had to build something better this time, something right, something true. Her hand was still against the beacon. The metallic taste of magic was in her mouth. And then, just like that, she swallowed it down. She pushed her weight against the cairn's wall. It sounded almost like the start of rain at first. One small stone dropping, then the next. Plop, plop, plop. But then suddenly there was a crash and rumble of rock down the mountain. That zap of magic went silent, like a candle going out. The look on the child's face made it all worth it. Wide-eyed horror.
What'd you do?
He cried out. Anit just laughed.
Child, she said. It's only stone. We'll build another beacon. One that works properly this time.
And your brother? And your first love?
Anit shrugged her thin, elderly shoulders.
If there's any magic in them, and I think there is, then they've got work ahead of them, too.
But how will they know? He whimpered, his chin shaking. They're so far away! And it's not like you...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.